Now, for many years, when people talk about creativity, they often link it with the idea of coloring outside the lines. But that doesn't really work for me. You can color outside the lines in your coloring book, but not in mine. I remember when I was a kid, I worked really hard to learn how to color inside the lines. I wanted to be able to do a smooth crayon fill, and somebody else had supplied the actual drawing that would turn it into a picture when I was done. That's what I wanted. And I always thought, if you want to color outside the lines, they have this wonderful invention called blank paper. There aren't any lines. You can color wherever you want on the page. And I think of that slogan from Outback Restaurant's advertising campaign, no rules. Now, when I want to go to a restaurant, I want to go to one that follows the rules. I want to have a certain finite number of rat feces and cockroach parts in my food. I want it below the minimum. I want the employees to strictly follow the rules about hand washing after using the toilet. Rules work, and they work even in things that are creative. In fact, they worked especially in creative endeavors. When I was a kid, I loved writing poetry. As soon as I discovered verse forms, I played with them. I loved rhyme. I loved scansion. And I really needed to make the scanning of a line perfect. In seventh grade, we dissected earthworms. And I discovered, not by accident, it was taught, that earthworms all had all the sexual parts, both sexes in each earthworm, and all of them worked. Now, this just blew me away. I thought this was such a wonderful invention. and it inspired me to write poetry. Here's the poem that I wrote. The poem that I wrote in seventh grade. The earthworm is a little odd. It hath hermaphroditic bod. And in its millimetric girth, it crawleth far beneath the earth and gaugeth in its menial toil amid the grimy, muddy soil. The earthworm doesn't know it's wed to Mary Bell instead of Fred, but all of this is idle chatter. To earthworms, things like this don't matter. For the earthworm doing what it oughter is half a son and half a daughter. But then I got to college. And in college, after we read Lord of the Rings, it was my generation that discovered it, after we read Jonathan Livingston Seagull, there was Rod McEwen. Rod McEwen is that most remarkable of all creatures, a best-selling poet. His poetry books, Listen to the Warm, Stanyan Street and Other Sorrows, climbed onto the bestseller lists and just sat there month after month, and it was because of students like me. It felt good to write poetry like Rod McEwen's. A gush of emotion in liquid language. But I was in a poetry class taught by Clinton Larson, an old family friend and a wonderful poet who knew and understood the uses of form. So I would write my melancholy, wistful, semi-tragic, adolescent, free-form poetry, and Clint read it with patience. And though it was undetectable in that poetry, he believed that I had talent. And so he took me aside and said, "All right, Scott, I don't want to see any more free verse from you until you have written 100 sonnets. And I don't mean just 14-line poems. I mean rhymed, metered, poems that scan, following the form." And I learned from that experience how liberating the form was. Because I couldn't just gush. The rules set problems that I had to solve creatively. I didn't settle for the first thought that came to mind. I didn't settle for the first rhyme that fit. I worked and worked until the reading of the poem was effortless. Because the goal was not to be emotional as I wrote. The goal was to write so that people would feel those emotions as they read. Creativity thrives best in solving problems in an environment of rules. Flexible rules but rules. And almost all human endeavors require creativity at every level. Now, an architect or an engineer, they don't design a building or a bridge. They design this building, this bridge, to be put in this site to accomplish this purpose, using the materials that will stand the stresses and the strains. And to accomplish all of this within the budget that is set. Those are a whole bunch of rules. But every successful building and every successful bridge, you hope they follow the rules. And yet there's an enormous amount of creativity in solving those problems. But now let me ask you, who creates the cathedral? Is it the architect or is it the mason? Now, the architect has the vision of the whole. And the mason had better follow his instructions and not just put a wall wherever he wants. But there aren't that many architects who actually know how to create a plumb, straight wall of masonry. They both build the cathedral. They're both the creators. When I go to hear a concert of the Goldberg Variations or Samuel Barber's Excursions, when I listen to that music, who is creating it? The composer or the pianist? Well, they both are, of course. They're both creative at every step along the way. You have to balance rules and inventions. When my son Jeffrey, oldest child, was in third grade, he was assigned by the most evil teacher I've ever known. This project wasn't evil. They were studying the ocean, and so they were supposed to do an art project on a little paper on the ocean. And that was the instruction. And so Jeffrey decided that he was going to create a three-dimensional model of the ocean floor using clay. Little starfish, little creatures, coral. It was really quite inventive and lovely. He did a wonderful job. And he got a very low grade for it. And then he told us that as it was on display in the room, other kids would come by and just smash it and pulverize it. And he pointed it out to the teacher, and the teacher did absolutely nothing to stop that. Well, we went and had a conversation with the teacher. The teacher said it was supposed to be a poster. And my wife kindly pointed out, she's the one who has to do the speaking in cases like this. The instructions said, art project, sculpture is an art. Well, the other parents all knew. Well, the other parents don't have our son. That was Jeffrey's experience. But then our daughter Emily discovered the cassette tape recorder. And for many years, every assignment she could possibly turn into a recording project became one. She would write scripts, put on the audio plays. There was one, for example, she was supposed to create a project on the Sistine Chapel. She did nothing visual at all. She just had conversations and interviews with workers and patrons. She enlisted her brother and her uncle to perform the parts. Her teachers loved what she did. I will point out that she's an audiobook narrator today as part of her living. Now, what did we do? What did we do as parents to allow our children's creativity to thrive? First of all, they had plenty of free time to explore and fail and start again. We had no idea of competition in our family. Nobody lost, nobody won. You just made stuff. We gave them the tools. They acquired the skills. We provided materials, whatever they asked for. We lived in a house full of books, with lots of talk, with plenty of movies, games, travel, news, knowledge, language, and love. And there was no adult control of how they would fulfill an assignment. But too often, schools today are trying to kill creativity and eliminate the joy of learning. You know that the best predictor of success in school is to have parents that the children see reading for pleasure on their own. When they might do something else, they choose to read, and parents who read to their kids. Well, our daughter Emily was a voracious reader, loved to read, and as she got into high school, her favorite books were big, thick biographies. She loved reading about other people's lives. So she was assigned one summer to keep a reading journal on a book that she had chosen herself. Every time she read, she was supposed to write a little report on the experience, whatever it is she read that day. She never got out of chapter one because she would read herself to sleep at night. But you can't do that if you have to stop at the end and write something. Now I explained to her, Emily, you've got to understand. Just read the book. And then at the end, make up a journal. That's what all the other kids are doing. Nobody is writing every time they read. And she said, Dad, that would be cheating. You can't argue with that when your kid tells you that. So the problem is that reading journal not only killed her reading of that book, but it killed her reading, period, for several years. It was quite a time before she could read for pleasure again. They had robbed her of the joy of reading. They do it to everybody with this horrible torture device called homework. When I was a kid, I almost never had homework because I finished the work in class. Homework was just whatever was left over from your in-school assignments. Nowadays, people subscribe to this absurd claim that the ideal amount of homework is 10 minutes per grade. First graders should have 10 minutes a night. 12th graders should have 2 hours a night of homework. There's no data behind that. That assertion was simply made out of the air. There was no study that backed that up. Worse yet, every study of homework, and I mean every study, when properly controlled and interpreted, reveals that homework makes no difference whatsoever to academic performance. But it makes a huge difference to the freedom of children. Because we have compulsory child labor in our society today. We make our kids work a day job and then go home and continue working at that same job at night. How many parents only have time to interact with their children while making them do homework? Because there is no other time. These kids don't have a life. I would say to schools, if you want to use those 6 hours, use them. You have the 6 hours during the day, and in those 6 hours, I think you have plenty of time to cover the curriculum that homeschoolers routinely cover in two. So except for rare, special, meaningful projects, stay out of our family time. The nighttime, the weekends and the summers and the vacations belong to us. You get 6 hours a day in school by law. Kids love to learn. They absolutely are thrilled with the things they're interested in. I remember when our son Jeffrey at school encountered a book about lizards. He was in love with lizards. So he made the family get together and play a game of charades where we would draw the name of a lizard out of a hat and then act out that lizard. And I have to tell you, I can act out lizard, but I cannot act out the difference between gecko and spink. It's just not possible for me. So he learned that we have our limitations, but he could do it. He could act out the differences. In businesses and organizations, though, working with adults, if you want to keep creative employees, you have to allow them to love their work. You have to let them explore. You don't always force them to do things the right way, which usually means the way you know. You have to let them think and try things. Let them make suggestions. You support them if you can. You may find out that your way is right. And they will have learned it for themselves, and then they'll believe it. They'll trust you. They'll know that it works. But you also may find out that their way is better, and now you have a new right way. Children need unsupervised play. So do adults. They need respect for their choices. They need to have a chance to fail. Our son Jeffrey is 16 years older than our youngest, Zina. And when Zina was coming into her teens, Jeffrey came to us and said, "Why does Zina get to take karate? I asked to take karate, and you wouldn't let me." And we said, "No, Jeffrey, we didn't not let you. We just told you, if you take karate, you will get kicked in the head. You will get punched, you will get knocked down, and you decided not to take karate." We told Zina the same thing, and Zina said, "I know, but I want to become more brave, and I want to not cry so much." And so she took karate, she got her junior black belt, she got kicked in the head, she got knocked down, she came home with some headaches. But she achieved her purpose, and we supported her in it. And I don't think Jeffrey missed a thing. I don't think that he would have thrived in that environment. Real creativity requires that you have a clear sense of what's good and what isn't good. If you can't hear pitch, you're probably not going to sing very well. I think Bob Dylan proves that. But a critical sense does not come from being criticized. It comes from criticizing third parties, people who are not present. You can look at their work, criticize it, discuss it, see what's good, see what isn't good. Early in our marriage, my wife and I read Judith Martin, Miss Manners' statement that we have lived by. No child needs to hear criticism on the day of the performance. We've lived by that, and you know what? By the next day, we really don't usually have much criticism to offer. Every now and then, something important enough to mention. Children love to learn, to create, to perform. The power to create well requires skills and knowledge of rules and free time and space in which to play. To foster creativity, you create that environment where courage is not punished, where others are free to find their own way to the goal, where toys are tools and tools are toys, and where the goal is to make good things, good systems, for other people to enjoy. Thank you.